like the Carnegie Foundation of New York, who funds our AIMS program. That's a program focused on Arab media and information studies, with the ACSS, which is the Arab Council for Social Sciences, etc. We also have a, you know, public program events. So we have a colloquium, we have book talks, we have conferences, and events such as the one that we're holding today, which is, you know, kind of a new signature kind of lecture on the Global South, a key, you know, inviting, you know, prominent leading figures of the field to come here. My job is just, you know, obviously to welcome you, to introduce our dean, Marwan Kredi, who would say a few words and introduce the speaker. Before doing this, I did want to kind of, you know, take a second to thank everybody that, you know, goes into these kinds of events. It's obviously a major, you know, production. So I wanted to thank everybody at IAS, Marina Krikoyan, Aziz Mariam, Krishna Sharma, also everybody in the production team, facilities who make, you know, these kinds of events possible. This is being live streams. All of this, you know, there's as you know, any of you've been part of organizing these kinds of things, it's important. You know, it's a major production, takes a lot of work. So wanted to just take that time to thank everybody, and you know, just wanted to introduce the next speaker, Dean Marwan Kredi, who's the Dean and CEO of Northwestern University in Qatar. And the founder of the Institute for Advanced Study in the Global South. So Marwan is a leading figure in global media studies, internationally, you know, kind of renowned for his work on Arab media, culture, politics, including on digital sovereignty, geopolitics of popular culture, theorizing from the South, things obviously, you know, kind of relevant to today's lecture. He's received, you know, fellowship from Carnegie, Guggenheim, the National Endowment for the Humanities, ACLS, and others, and I won't, you know, mention them all. He's written over 130 essays and articles, published 13 books, including Hybridity and the Cultural Logics of Globalization, Reality Television and Arab Politics, and his latest book, The Naked Blogger of Cairo, which was published in 2016 from Harvard University Press, has won several major awards. The floor is yours, Marwan.
So I want to join Clovis in thanking everybody who made this possible. But I want to begin with our custodial staff who keep the room clean and allow us to have comfortable, enjoyable, healthy events. I want to thank, of course, the digital media production folks who are here helping us memorialize the event and sharing it very widely, including with our colleagues in Evanston and Chicago. Of course, I want to thank our facilities management team, the security guards, again, everybody who makes this possible. And I want to thank Clovis and Marina. Clovis is the assistant director for research at the Institute. Marina is the research manager for programs and projects. Krishna Sharma is, do you know who they are? Why don't you all stand up, the Institute staff, please. Krishna is our administrative assistant, and Zist Mariam, where's Zist? Hi, Zist. Zist is our alumni fellow. I also would like to recognize the postdocs. Could you, all four of you, could you please stand up? Yasmin Shelikol is here, Shafiq Najem, Harsha Van Marajan, and where's Mariam? Is Mariam here? Mariam Karim, okay, hi. I also want to recognize all the undergraduate fellows. I believe naming them would mean I would be giving the lecture instead of Herman, so I won't, but could you please stand up, any of the Institute fellows who are in the room? All right, thank you. Thank you for coming. And I also want to recognize that Tanya Bosch, who's a professor at the University of Cape Town, is here as a global visiting scholar. So it's yay, South Africa. All right, so let me now move to our distinguished speaker. I'm very happy to host Professor Herman Wasserman here at NUQ. We've been talking about this for years and it finally happened. Herman is a media studies scholar, professor, but also the chair of the Department of Journalism at Stellenbosch University, whose academic career began in the early 2000s after spending several years working as a journalist in Cape Town. Prior to his current role, Herman was a professor of media studies at the University of Cape Town, where he notably served as the director of the Center for Film and Media Studies, where Tanya is now a professor. So, worlds coming together. Herman is widely recognized for his work on media in post-apartheid South Africa. His publications include more than 80 articles in peer-reviewed journals, book chapters, co-authored books, monographs. These include Media, Geopolitics, and Power, A View from the Global South. That's my favorite book by Herman. But also Tabloid Journalism in South Africa, True Story, and China's Media and Soft Power in Africa, Promotion and Perceptions. His most recent edited book, which is sitting on my desk, if any one of you wants to borrow it, is Disinformation in the Global South, which gathered a diverse perspective, a bunch of truly cutting-edge chapters on misinformation and disinformation in the Global South, and highlights his continuous engagement with this topic. I want to mention also that in addition to this scholarly work, Herman has served as a consultant for multiple media, NGOs, and international organizations, including UNESCO, that's the UN Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, Deutsche Welle Akademie, the German public broadcaster and its academy, the Digital Public Square, Africa Check, and the Center for International Media Assistance. He also serves on the Scientific Committee of Reporters Without Borders, is a fellow of the International Communication Association, and is an elected member of the Academy of Science of South Africa. I am delighted to have a scholar and a former journalist of Herman's stature joining us today for this important conversation. And I hope, knowing Herman, I think we're gonna learn a lot. So keep your questions to the end. And if you are so inclined, we are at, of course, NUQ Qatar on social media, or IAS at NUQ, and please use my favorite hashtag, NUQ Proud. Herman, welcome.
Next time.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for this kind introduction. Thank you also very much for the invitation to be here. It's been a delight, and it's also a great honor for me to be here. I also want to echo Dean Crady's thank you to everybody who has made this happen. I know from also organizing these sort of events how much effort goes into it, and also how much unseen work goes on behind the scenes, so thank you very much. And thank you also very much to everybody today. I have had some really interesting and stimulating conversations today, and I've learned a lot. So the topic of my talk here this afternoon is Disinformation in the Global South, Critique, Contexts, and Cases. We have all heard the words fake news, disinformation, post-truth society, and these are buzzwords that tell us that something has shifted in our public sphere. We are witnessing a global information disorder, large-scale contamination of the public sphere with false information, online hate, dangerous conspiracy theories, harmful misunderstandings, and orchestrated campaigns of deception. This disorder is often seen as resulting from recent changes in the media landscape, a new digital media ecology which brought about a crisis for established news media, but also a fractious political environment, heightened polarization, a rise in populism and ethno-nationalism across the world. But the problem also has its roots in much older social and cultural histories, political economies and power relations, which become especially evident when viewed from the perspective of the Global South. Furthermore, aspects related to information disorders such as disinformation, fake news, the risks of artificial intelligence, online hate, these issues have all become key concerns in scholarship. But not only in academic work and academic realm, but also in communication practice, in journalism, and political discourse. We hear these terms resonate more and more. However, and I think this is where I want to take my starting point this afternoon, is that this growth in scholarly production as well as popular discourses has been dominated by perspectives from the global north. In this regard, the study of information disorder replicates the asymmetrical knowledge production of our field of communication and media studies as a whole. And this is unfortunate, not only from the perspective of epistemic justice or equity in knowledge production, important as these objectives are, but also because it creates an incomplete picture of the problem as it exists globally. The history, social dynamics, and power relations attendant upon information disorder are very pronounced in the global south. And understanding these factors in that context can also provide insights to drivers of disinformation elsewhere. So in this presentation this afternoon, I want to firstly engage critically with knowledge production in the area of disinformation studies. And then I would like to argue for the importance of the Global South as a context and lens through which we focus disinformation. And I'll have a specific focus on Africa, as that is my area of study and expertise, but I'll also touch on other areas of the Global South. And lastly, I want to discuss some cases or point to some cases that illustrate the importance of a socio-technical approach to disinformation from the perspective of the majority world. In doing so, I will draw on research that I've been doing, not only on my own, but also in collaboration with others. As you can see on these maps, that includes surveys and focus groups in several sub-Saharan African countries, and also across the Global South. Marwan mentioned the book that I've edited with Danny Madrid Morales that include discussions from around the Global South, and I also currently lead a multi-country team investigating information disorder in Latin America, the MENA region, sub-Saharan Africa, and Asia. I mention this because in these projects I also work with other academic colleagues, but also with fact-checking organizations, policy analysts, media literacy experts from civil society, because the problem of disinformation is such a multi-leveled and a multifaceted phenomenon that we need these collaborations. And I'll say a little bit more about these collaborations a bit later on. So to start with the first critique I would like to offer is that of concepts. So before we look at the cases and examples from the Global South in context, it's first important to, I think, consider the theoretical and conceptual framework from within which this work takes place. Although there's been a strong growth in the study of disinformation in recent years, it is still an evolving field. And this evolution can be seen in the lack of consensus on definitions and epistemology. Not only in disinformation itself, it's also, of course, important, I think, just to note that the notion of the Global South itself is by no means a simple and uncontested concept. And this is perhaps not the place for that specific discussion. Safe to say that I use the Global South as a term, maybe following Gayatri Spivak's notion of a strategic essentialism, as a term of solidarity and political orientation, while remaining aware of the heterogeneity and complexity of this region. So I'm not using it necessarily as a geographical term or in nationalistic terms even, but as a political and historical lens. The first concept of information disorder, which consists of mis, dis, and malinformation, as coined by Wardle and Derakhshan, has become a very influential concept. It defines misinformation as false information, which is shared but not with no harm that is intended. Disinformation as false information, which is knowingly shared with the intent to cause harm. And malinformation as information which is genuine but shared to cause harm, often by moving information from the private to the public sphere, such as doxing and trolling and hate speech and so on. Although this topology goes some way to distinguish between different types of harmful information, it hinges on the ability to establish intent as the defining characteristic. And that intent is not always possible to establish, because it means that the definition of a particular message might have to change and shift as it moves through the media ecology. Send out a message that is disinformation, intent to harm, but somebody else shares it without the intent to harm, then it becomes misinformation. And you can see there's a problem there. The second term that's also quite important or quite prevalent is that of fake news. That is still widely used in popular and journalistic discourse. And there's fairly broad agreement that this should be avoided, at least in academic terms. Firstly, because it's imprecise, it can refer to forms of satire that are intended as a critique of journalism, for instance. But mostly because it has become weaponized by politicians such as Donald Trump, precisely to attack journalists and undermine the legitimacy of journalism. Another critique of the emerging field is that it often assumes novelty, as if disinformation is an entirely new problem. Of course, some aspects of disinformation are new, such as the speed and the reach of false information on social media, or the use of advanced technologies such as AI. These are undisputably new. But there's also often a slippage between the notion of disinformation and older concepts such as soft power and propaganda, which have a much longer theoretical history. And that history, theoretical history, is often neglected in overly broad uses of disinformation as if this is something that has only emerged in the last few years. Another critique that has to do with the simplistic binaries that are often set up between falsehoods and facts, or between information disorder and information integrity. And that tends to present mainstream news often as the panacea to the problem of information disorder. And it's sometimes based on a somewhat positivistic view of journalism, media, and communication. These binaries, often used defensively to counter the problem, tend to underplay the ways in which journalism and the news media are often sometimes, or they are always themselves embedded in political economies. But they are also sometimes contribute to the problem. And what counts as journalistic truth is produced within networks of power. And sometimes these overly simplistic notions of journalism and news media as a counter to disinformation forgets the whole critique as if Foucault, Said, and Chomsky never happened. So this simplistic binary runs the risk of leaving journalism itself unexamined and uncritiqued. And lastly, I think there's also a risk that a focus on information disorder in the public sphere as something new might neglect the long scholarly history from Nancy Fraser onwards, which critiqued the public sphere in itself as a supposedly rational, democratic, and participatory environment, which we know it isn't. The field has also been criticized for exaggerating the scope and impact of the problem to serve as an alibi for a constellation of politicians, researchers, and big tech, what Joseph Bernstein called big disinfo, to decide what information to allow into the public sphere. So these conceptual problems suggest that there is a need for more theory building in the field, more comparative and more granular socio-technical research that can be operationalized within contexts. And this is, I think, where a focus on the Global South also becomes very important, because the Global South can provide a social, cultural, and geopolitical perspective on these theories and the theory building that needs to happen in the Global South and globally. So what we need is more theory building and more conceptual critique as well. What is also important is the contextual critique. And this is, I think, is where we see that the field of disinformation studies is still overwhelmingly focused on the Global North. There's a sharp rise in both popular interest and scholarly production, which can be tracked back to the 2016 presidential election in the US, which was characterized by the weaponizing of the term fake news, where also concerns about foreign influence operation and the spread of conspiracy theories became quite prevalent. Let me just quickly go to the previous slide. Sorry, I skipped one. And the genesis of the field in the Global North means that disinformation research still lacks geographical, cultural, linguistic, and geopolitical diversity. Not only has relatively low attention been paid to the history and manifestation of disinformation in the Global South, but very few comparative studies have been undertaken so far. In order to grow and deepen the field, we need more data and evidence from the Global South, but this is often expensive to gather as it requires surveys, interviews, fieldwork. And the political economy of global knowledge production means that researchers in the Global South often struggle to find the resources to do that important work. And now let me go on to this slide, where I think it is also important to note that the problem of disinformation as a field and the focus, the overwhelming focus on the Global North, is compounded by the political economy of global scholarly publishing. On these slides, and they may be a bit far away, but you can see findings of the research that my colleague Danny and I have undertaken of articles published in SSCI-ranked journals. These are the top impact, high-impact journals in our field over two decades. And this research over there shows from 2000 to 2020. And here you can see on the left, top left there, how the growth of articles that mention fake news, misinformation, disinformation in the abstract, how rapidly they've grown from 2015 to 2020. On the bottom left, you can see a picture of how the Americas, the red part there, how that dominates those same abstracts. And similarly, you can see at the bottom right there the lack of comparative and non-comparative studies. So the red there signifies non-comparative work, and the little brown block there at the bottom is comparative work. So you can see that scholarly production in the area is also still hugely skewed to the global north. But why then is it important to study disinformation from the perspective of the global north, from the global south? As I've already said, the global south provides a context in which the historical, political, economic, and social drivers of disinformation are very pronounced. Understanding these contextual drivers can hold lessons for how disinformation operates and can be countered in other parts of the world as well. Countries in the global south have shared experience of colonialism, marginalization, and authoritarianism. And this means, this history of colonialism and authoritarianism means that they also have a long historical experience of propaganda, manipulated news, and state control over media, which enable these political systems. One can maybe even argue that colonialism was the biggest disinformation operation known to man. Even when disinformation manifests in contemporary times, it's often rooted in these much older networks of power, social, and cultural dynamics. The global south is generally characterized by big socioeconomic inequalities, ethnic tensions, racism, gender disparities, and all these factors provide a foothold for disinformation and foreign influence to take hold. An example of this was the Bell-Pottinger campaign in South Africa a number of years ago, where the hashtag white monopoly capital was weaponized, or weaponized the huge socioeconomic inequalities that persist after apartheid in South Africa and still do correspond with race. It exploited those inequalities in a hired disinformation for hire campaign to deflect corruption allegations against the former president, Jacob Zuma. So you can see how these inequalities and historical legacies now provide the opportunity for actors to exploit them for disinformation purposes. The history of authoritarian and state control over information and media in the global south has also bred a distrust in official narratives. Because much of the news media during the colonial and post-colonial eras was state-owned or controlled, and in many African countries, for instance, the state still wields large influence over media. Because of those historical factors, alternative networks of communication often became more trusted than the news media or information from other authoritative sources. This includes gossip. Stephen Ellis, in his well-known article, spoke about pavement radio, radio trottoir, the radio of the pavement where gossip and stories circulate because people trust that more than official news narratives. Satire and jokes are also hugely important in these contexts. And they often provide a progressive, or historically they serve the progressive function to undermine colonial authority, but they can also provide a foothold for disinformation. What is important, though, is to understand that this cultural history can also help us understand how the communication ecologies today are still marked and still influenced by those communicative practices and social histories. Attention to context in the global south may also hold lessons for the global north, and my colleague Guy Berger reminded us in a piece that he wrote as a foreword for our book. He reminded us, for instance, that Ukraine was a target of geopolitical interference long before this geopolitical interference, that is, became a concern in the 2016 U.S. elections. Disinformation was weaponized in the Philippines towards journalists like the Nobel laureate Maria Ressa before accusations of fake news in the U.S. led to hostility towards journalists in that country. We have learned from Facebook whistleblowers how the social platform was complicit in hate speech against the Myanmar military, by the Myanmar military against the Rohingya before similar tactics were used in divisive social media messages in domestic US policies, politics. So a focus on Global South can help us, therefore, to understand how disinformation is embedded in a range of social, political, and economic conditions, and how they map onto historical experiences and older concerns about communication. Yet for such comparisons to be made, disinformation first has to be understood inductively within context in order to identify the drivers, the histories, and the power relations that underpin those practices. Once these specific contextual textures are discerned, only then can extrapolation and comparison start, not the other way around, I would argue. A better understanding of these drivers can also lead to more contextually appropriate responses, rather than a one-size-fits-all approach that is imported from elsewhere. And that becomes a problem in terms of regulation, and I'll touch upon that a bit later. So now that we've considered the conceptual and the contextual critiques of the field of disinformation, let's move on to the context of the Global South itself. Just how big a problem is disinformation in the Global South? And that's difficult to quantify, because what do you measure? Do you measure the number of posts or information that is circulated? How do you label it? It's a difficult and complex task. What we can do, maybe a bit more easily, is to quantify the people's experience of disinformation. In this regard, survey research that we have done shows high perceived exposure to disinformation in sub-Saharan Africa, for instance, higher than in the US. We used the same methods. We replicated a Pew research study that was done in the US to ask people how often do they think they are exposed to a story that is completely made up. You can see the top left, graph there. The question that we asked, how often do you come across news stories about politics and government online that you think are completely made up? And the USA is that gray graph. Kenya, Nigeria, and South Africa, people perceived that exposure to be much higher. Other research, for instance, from the Reuters Institute Digital News Report, the graph here at the bottom, this was done during the COVID pandemic, when people were asked, how concerned are you about the spread of disinformation, fake or misleading information on social media platforms? And you can see in the Global South, again, Brazil, Indonesia, India, Nigeria, US, UK, Philippines are those different countries there. Very high concern about the growing concern about disinformation and hate speech on messaging platforms, especially like WhatsApp. Yet another way of measuring the extent of the problem in the Global South is by looking at the reaction that this problem or the perception of this problem is eliciting. In this regard, there's also been a steep increase in punitive fake news laws issued by governments in the Global South, using the problem of disinformation either as an alibi to suppress dissent, or maybe as an unintended consequence, a chilling effect on journalism. In Africa alone, the number of such fake news laws have doubled in the space of 5 years from 2016 to 2021. So that's a huge concern in terms of what that means for freedom of expression. So although there's a need for more attention to disinformation in the Global South and more comparative studies, the Global South is not a singular place and should not be homogenized. Different experiences around disinformation are experiences both within countries and across countries in the Global South. And these differences might appear along linguistic, gender, income level, or ethnicity, rather than national borders. And that complexity requires us to start doing more complex research or more complex research designs that take into account these diversities within the groups alongside the nation as the most suitable unit of analysis. Social media platforms and mobile phone apps such as WhatsApp also start providing transnational spaces for disinformation to spread, often along linguistic or cultural networks in the diaspora. Something like WhatsApp is platform is hugely influential in the diaspora. So the more we understand about the differences in the impact of disinformation within and across regions in the Global South, and how disinformation flows across these online and offline spaces, the more important transnational organizations and transnational networks combating disinformation becomes clear. And again, why it is so important for us as scholars to work transnationally, comparatively, and also work with civil society and other organizations. So what we need is more contextual approaches that compare dynamics across regions and countries of the global south. And these contexts, I would say, are at least four major contexts that I would like to look at in turn. One is media contexts, the second is socioeconomic contexts, political contexts, and geopolitical contexts. So let's start with media contexts. One thing that media across the global south has in common is that it's often characterized by high levels of concentration. Media are often state-controlled or state-owned. They are enmeshed in patrimonial relationships or captured by elite interests. And when we therefore talk of echo chambers, filter bubbles, not the same thing, but often used in social media research, when we talk about audiences that are only exposed to information which confirm their own biases, this is not only true of social media. In the global south, the mainstream news media can also serve as echo chambers, serving much older networks of class, language, race, and ethnicity, which are now organized often according to a market logic. For these reasons, news media in the global south often experience a lack of trust among audiences, or they present different perspectives that do not resonate with large parts of society. And in the South African context, for instance, the print media has been critiqued by Stephen Friedman, the political commentator, as saying it provides a perspective on the world from the globe, from the suburbs. So looking at the world from a suburban point of view. And that's often a problem with news media, especially print media in the African context. And what happens then is that people are then drawn to alternative sources of information. This lack of trust in news media can also be seen in the results of survey research that we conducted. The graph there might be a bit small from where you're sitting, but this was survey research done in Kenya, Nigeria, and South Africa, where we found low and decreasing levels of trust in local media. And that is also related to the perceived exposure to disinformation. Even when independent critical news organizations do good work, they are often under-resourced or mostly under-resourced. The journalists are poorly paid if they are not or irregularly paid, or they are at risk. And these pressures undermine journalists' ability to counter disinformation and to engage with audiences and to elicit more trust. Independent journalism in the global south is frequently also under pressure from authoritarian governments, which display an intolerance for criticism. And that intolerance for criticism, a long-standing problem among countries in the global south, is now amplified by online attacks on journalists, trolling, doxing, online hate, and violence, often directed at women journalists. As you can see on the picture there at the bottom, that was from the Bell Pottinger campaign, where quite badly photoshopped picture of a journalist on the lap of a rich capitalist, and saying that the news media is captured by capital, white monopoly capital. The bottom there, picture of journalists calling them prostitutes. So these sort of online doxing and hateful campaigns against journalists undermine the ability of journalism to do its work. The historical legacy of fragile media system in the global south is now being exacerbated by global neoliberalism. Countries in the region are often important emerging markets for digital platform companies. Big global platforms such as Facebook and Twitter are acting as gatekeepers of information, while at the same time acting as amplifiers of disinformation. Facebook's own fact-checking is hugely skewed towards the global north. Only 9% of Facebook users globally speak English, but 87% of the money spent at combating disinformation on Facebook is directed at English language content. Not only is there a lack of moderation in languages other than English, but moderators that lack knowledge of the specific cultural context might not recognize disinformation and hate speech that is very cleverly hidden in innuendo. A recent Mozilla report on TikTok and elections in Kenya has shown how references to post-election violence in previous ethnic-based violence in previous elections were missed by moderators. Messaging services like WhatsApp are hugely important in the global south and among its diaspora, as I've already mentioned, and they play a double role, a sort of double-edged sword. They offer both refuge from surveillance, because the messages are encrypted, and often a safer space, not a completely safe space, but a safer space, for instance, to criticize governments. But they also serve as channels of hate speech and disinformation, which is then very difficult to penetrate because of this encryption. And although artificial intelligence is still a relatively new phenomenon, there's already concerns about the use of large language models for astroturfing and also deep fakes being used in political disinformation. You can see example there on the screen. That was a recent deep fake. The top picture there is Zambian President Hakainde Hichilema, which supposedly announced his retirement from politics, and that deep fake was circulated on Twitter. So these technological advancements or developments pose regulatory challenges. How to regulate and moderate this is a question that is very difficult to solve. But what is important is that these regulations are not merely important from the north. There's a lot of work being done around, for instance, the DSA and so on in Europe. And however well-meaning it might be to try and transpose those regulatory measures to the global south, in authoritarian environments, such regulatory measures could also serve as a smokescreen to suppress freedom of speech, as I've already mentioned in relation to the fake news laws in Africa. So regulation should certainly not be left to governments alone, but should involve a range of different stakeholders to ensure that regulation is balanced with freedom of expression, especially environments where freedom of expression is fragile. The next context, which I think is important to note, is social cultural context. If we follow a social technical approach to disinformation, in other words, we don't only look at technological or technical manifestations of disinformation in isolation, but we see that within the broader society, it is important not only to focus on the content of the message and the affordances of a specific platform, but also on the social dynamics, such as audience perceptions and interactions with platforms. So context then becomes crucially important. Focus group research we've done in 6 sub-Saharan African countries, Ghana, Kenya, Nigeria, South Africa, Zambia, and Zimbabwe, as well as survey research in South Africa and Kenya, has shown us how social and cultural factors drive people's motivation for sharing disinformation. And that is often done knowingly. So people would share disinformation even if they think it is false. And the context there, this was the top screen there, motivations for sharing rumors about COVID-19 in China, that in Kenya and South Africa, for instance, you can see the top motivation there was, it is my duty to warn others. In other words, a very strong orientation, a very strong commitment to community, to your closest family members or friends. And so people would share that disinformation because they think it might help people down the line. Another motivating factor was satire and humor. People would say, I will share this just for fun because, you know, life is difficult and people need a laugh. I'm just sharing it for fun. Again, here you can hear how that older ecologies of communication, those older practices of satire and humor resonate in these findings. Audience experiences also differ across rural and urban settings. Focus group research that we've done in sub-Saharan Africa also show that rural communities use social networks much less than the urban counterparts, and that they rely much more on opinion leaders, local experts, family, community, and religious networks. Similarly, our online study of vaccine hesitancy in South Africa showed us that there's much more trust often in family members than in government or social media. Which means that we also have to think about how disinformation circulates offline between people in these networks. Religious identity and appeals to tradition or indigenous knowledge also feature prominently when media users consider the veracity of information and its relevance to their lives. That could be seen again in some of the disinformation around the COVID-19 pandemic in Africa. The slide there, the top person, there, sort of top left, that was the former judge president in South Africa, Mogoeng Mogoeng, who raised suspicions around COVID-19 vaccine, said if it's the work of the devil meant to infuse 666 in the lives of people, corrupt their DNA, it should be destroyed. This is a leading judge in South Africa appealing to that religious notion. The right-hand slide there was a former president of Tanzania, John Magufuli, who say that people should use indigenous medicines, steaming, traditional practices to kill the COVID-19 virus, and he himself then later on succumbed to the virus. So conservative cultural attitudes also drive hate speech in these regions, and that's often exploited in political campaigns. So sociocultural dynamics are really important to consider, but so are political contexts. And when we consider the political dynamics in the Global South, we see that the region is frequently marked by upheaval, protest, and conflict, which impacts on media and communication. Frequently, elections are disrupted by disinformation, false news about opponents circulating, astroturfing, bots. They are all starting to play an increasingly important role. In several Asian countries, this is done by state-backed or political party-aligned online actors, as we found in that comparative study that I have been involved with teams from the MENA region and from Asia. They're called IT cells in India, troll factories in the Philippines, buzzers in Indonesia, cyber troops in Malaysia, or cyber armies in Nepal. And given the poor economic conditions in the Global South, such social media promotion for political parties or the government can become an important source of revenue. Again, economic conditions that can be exploited. In a recent article, my colleague Sahana Udupa, who does really important work on ethnographic work on WhatsApp, in India, has noted how in India the so-called shadow politics, this disinformation, false news, influencing behind the scenes, has become an intrinsic part of political communication. It's become an established feature of mainstream politics in India. And I think this is probably going to be an increasingly mainstream facet of mainstream politics everywhere. The rise of ethno-nationalism, which we are currently seeing around the world, not only in the Europe and the US, or maybe I should say the other way around, not only in the Middle East, Asia, and Africa, but also in Europe and the US, where candidates are targeted for hate attacks on the basis of their ethnicity, religion, or nationality, again, impacts on the integrity of political processes. Governments are themselves often sources of disinformation, and while governmental disinformation can be resisted in contexts where there is freedom of speech to do so, to resist, it is much more difficult and much more dangerous to do that in authoritarian contexts where dissidence is not tolerated. Populist leaders in the Global South also use this information to pander to their base, and we have there many examples of this, from Bolsonaro's COVID denialism in Brazil, the xenophobia in South Africa and elsewhere. Long-standing social polarizations that often date back to colonialism's divide and rule politics are still being exploited for political ends. I've mentioned the Bell-Pottinger example in South Africa. So again, this social polarization, and it's not the neat binary. We had a discussion earlier today with one of the undergraduate fellows here. That binaries is not between two bipartisan politics as in the US, but often takes much more complex forms, much more fractious forms that cut across race, ethnicity, language, and gender. So that often harkens back to the divide and rule politics of colonialism. This is borne out by our focus group research in sub-Saharan African countries, where people have expressed a strong desire for political elites and governments to stop misinformation, but it's difficult for them to really appeal to their governments if the governments are going to use regulation as a double-edged sword to also suppress criticism. We see that the internet is also becoming a weapon, or maybe I should say the lack of internet is becoming a weapon for intolerant governments, because there's a widespread use of internet shutdowns or intentional crashes, not of the internet, not only in Africa, but also in Asia, to stifle criticism of government, especially around elections. And again, this creates a space for rumors and unverified information to flourish. Lastly, I want to move on to geopolitical context. And we mentioned at the outset that the field is marked by conceptual vagueness. But we also see this vagueness when we speak about geopolitics, because the lines between strategic communication, foreign influence operation, soft power, disinformation, those lines are often very blurry. What might be seen as soft power or propaganda by some is seen by disinformation, by others, depending on where you stand. But what is clear is that there's a geopolitical battle between powerful countries for influence in the global south, and social and online media are increasingly the battleground for this battle. We often also see collaboration between foreign and domestic information actors. One example of this is what has been referred to as information laundering. Example, for instance, in South Africa, where the Chinese news agency Xinhua got a local journalist to write a story on the so-called biolab in Ukraine, a conspiracy theory in a local newspaper, which has a strong Chinese investment, independent online. And then Xinhua would use that same report that they planted and quoted in the same story as South African media reports that. So you see how disinformation becomes laundered and cleaned, and people don't know where the original origins are from. Influence operations also exploit long-standing regional tensions, as we've seen with the Wagner Group in the Sahel in Africa. Or on another level, how campaigns seeking to undermine South Africa's case against Israel at the ICJ recently has unleashed a disinformation campaign about so-called white genocide at home, saying, you know, this is a country that's taking Israel to the ICJ, but they have a genocide of white people at home, which is completely, completely false. So we are seeing all sorts of foreign influence, not only in elections, but also in other sort of geopolitical tensions, other geopolitical battles. And if recent admissions by the team Jorge of meddling in elections in Venezuela, Nigeria, and Kenyan elections is anything to go by, this is the year of elections. There's many elections happening across Africa and the rest of the world, very important ones in the US as well. I think we should buckle up and get ready for some serious meddling ahead. When it comes to geopolitical disinformation, I think it is also important to follow this socio-technical approach that I've mentioned. And that means that we should not only think about geopolitics in terms of information that can be debunked and corrected and fact-checked, but that we see this geopolitical disinformation within the larger context of historical legacies and attitudes. Most recently, this can be seen in the way Russia in Africa activates memory diplomacy, as it has been called, in its strategic narratives, reminding African audiences of its role in the anti-colonial liberation struggles, and also amplifying growing and persistent anti-Western attitudes in Africa. So the influence of attitudes, people's perspectives, people's historical legacies towards geopolitical actors, more than the content of specific messages, is very important. And this can be seen in the survey we conducted last year in three sub-Saharan African countries, Angola, Ethiopia, South Africa, and Zambia. In these countries, we found that in individuals' worldviews, particularly anti-US sentiment, is a much more stronger predictor of supporting Chinese and Russian strategic disinformation narratives than the content of the narrative itself. In other words, the problem is not the message that is going to change people's minds, it is that messages are reinforcing anti-US sentiment that is there for a much longer time. So for instance, what we found is that seeing the US as an enemy associated with believing disinformation is a strong predictor of people believing statements such as the war in Ukraine is a consequence of NATO's expansion in Eastern Europe. If we ask people of that question, if people have already demonstrated that they have a strong anti-US sentiment, they're more likely to believe the message. So understanding the historical context and audience attitudes is the first precondition before you can start debunking and fact-checking these narratives. So again, socio-technical approaches rather than just focusing on the content of the message itself. Let me close by looking at how these various contexts can then help us understand what might be the best responses, because we know that there's a problem, but how do we combat that problem? In our scoping research of organizations that work in to counter disinformation in the global south, it is clear that these organizations, and I list some of them there on the slide, it's clear that these organizations understand that disinformation is only one dimension of a much broader set of issues plaguing the region. This means that disinformation cannot be tackled in isolation, but should form part of a broader strategy, which recognize that disinformation is linked to much many other problems attendant upon the information and communication landscape. So, for instance, the quality of information that circulates is linked to rights of access to information and digital technologies. Work done by the ALSUR Consortium in Latin America has shown us how it is important to also fight for the right of people to access information and digital technologies, that there's important policy interventions on cybersecurity, surveillance, and data protection, because you cannot expect people to believe and adopt and share good information if they don't have access to it, if they don't have surveillance of what they do online, if there's not data protection. Anti-disinformation work is also linked with media freedom and the right to protest. And this is the work that Article 19 in Latin America, or Kashif in Palestine, is doing when it combats hate speech, so that it allows people to also protest and fight for media freedom alongside attempts to improve the environment, the information environment. Electoral disinformation is linked with internet rights. For instance, advocacy campaigns engaging politicians and digital platforms in Mexico. And fact-checking is linked with media literacy initiatives in West Africa and elsewhere in Africa. So what we see is that, in other words, these organizations understand that in order to fight disinformation, you also have to improve media literacy. You have to improve people's access to information. You have to ensure that they operate in an environment where there is freedom for them to speak their minds. And also that debunking information or poor information goes hand in hand with fostering democratic attitudes. So in conclusion, when we look at all these contexts with which are important to understand disinformation in the Global South, we firstly have to understand what the drivers of the problem are. And this would require us a deeper knowledge of history, society, culture, and the political economy. We cannot treat disinformation in the Global South as if it is something that is A, very recent, and B, that is just a replication of the problem as it exists in the Global North. Therefore, for us as scholars, the first priority should be to develop more research. Just quantify that we need more research on information disorder in the Global South. But we also, when we do this research, we should avoid just replicating models from the North for the sake of more diversity, which is often a problem in often, again, very well-meaning attempts to diversify scholarship, is that you use a theory or a concept from the Global North and you just bring in more case studies and examples and illustrations from the Global South, and then you have diversity and you have inclusion. What you have to do is also to disrupt the theories and the frameworks and the approaches in the Global North by starting from the Global South, starting from the ground up, starting from the context, and disrupt some of these frameworks that might not be applicable. As we do so, it is important that we also engage in critical praxis as scholars, that we connect scholarship with the work of civil society, with NGOs, activists, journalists, often working at very difficult conditions at the coalface, and it is important for us as academics to also collaborate with them, and broaden our inquiries beyond online communities to also look at how disinformation spreads offline and do ethnographic research. All of this assumes that disinformation is a multi-leveled phenomenon, a phenomenon rooted in history, social conditions, economic conditions, inequality, geopolitics, and that it will require multidisciplinary collaborations if we are to counter this in future. Thank you very much for your attention. Yes, happy to do so. Please, maybe if you want to raise your hand and also just say who you are, and I'll try and see. It's in front here. Yes.
Thank you, Herman. I'm Rajiv. I'm a faculty here, recently joined. So my question is that when you talk about the media context, and in a brief way, in one sentence, you highlighted the challenges of AI and deepfakes. So if I take the context of archaeology of knowledge and put that in context of political economy of platform, where disinformation, misinformation, malinformation is being spread. So how do you, I would like to be interested to know that how do you think the use of AI or deepfakes supported by state actors can in future become so much sedimented since?
To think of it from a global south perspective, and I'm thinking of things like, I know in Guinea, the context I noted a bit, in Africa, with a lot of the disinformation or the mistrust around information around COVID-19 came from kind of disinformation that happened with the Ebola epidemic that in 2014, where there was kind of, from Global North organization, there was kind of misinformation used to kind of trick people into kind of, vaccines or so that tactics were also used by the West. And I know, one of our fellow, and I think you met them today, is also working on this in Pakistan, in certain areas where the CIA organized, kind of campaigns, fake vaccination campaigns to capture, Bin Laden, and how much of these things are also present. So when you're looking at it, you're looking at Putin and, China, Russia, but you're also looking at kind of, history of disinformation that is not just in these. So that was my question.
Thank you. There was another question over there, just, and maybe shall I take that one, and then we can maybe have another round.
I'm Lila. This is very much. I'm a journalism freshman. My question would be on, for example, in like certain region, for example, in the countries where data is manipulated by the government or the corporations. In that case, what kind of approach that we can take, maybe, or how to analyze the data or get a trustworthy data in that case? That would be my question.
Okay, thank you. These are all very challenging questions, so I'll try and respond to some of them, but it's maybe good for us to just start a conversation. We're starting with the question on AI and deepfakes. To be honest, I think this is such a new area, certainly in how it manifests and how it will manifest in elections in Africa, for instance. I think that we don't have a clear picture yet of what will happen, but I think if I understand you correctly, I think, well, firstly, the sedimentation of this, and I think that is really important, important question, because there is this sort of circulation in large language models that it trains itself on existing data. And I think although there are attempts to try and weed that out, I think it's certainly a call for vigilance. And that is, it is quite a scary thought that what we consider knowledge in itself and the sort of history of knowledge could be skewed in that way. I do think that it is important also here to, and you mentioned foreign actors, I think what is important here is that there is also this asymmetry maybe in access to the technologies that make this sort of deepfakes and so on possible. It is probably going to be another case of deepfakes for hire maybe. So. And the ability to people to counter them. At the moment, that for instance, that one that I had up there of the Zambian case, it's so crude still that you can easily recognize it, and it's not at that level yet, I think, where it poses a serious risk. But again, maybe a question that one could ask is to what extent those sort of things re-entrench or confirm people's existing biases and not necessarily introduce new things into the sphere, but reintroduce or reaffirm people's existing biases. In terms of the Turkey example, thank you for that. I think that is a really important one. There are some, I think, increasingly the understanding that of the limitations of fact checking. So, firstly, that fact checking, tackles the content and assumes that maybe if you debunk something, then people will believe the correct information, whereas often this is rooted in a much deeper social and cultural histories. We've seen that in COVID, where you can throw any amount of scientific facts at people often, if they've made up their minds, then it's not going to change them, because it has to do with their social identities or where they feel they belong. So if you belong in a specific community and not believing in vaccines as part of your community identity, whatever scientific debunking you do is unlikely to shift you. But in terms of the government-sponsored fact-checking, and I think there is that concern that, you know, who is going to fact-check the fact-checkers? And what we've seen, maybe to put a slightly different spin on it, is that what we've also seen in the African context is often that fact-checkers take money from Meta, for instance, from platforms. And that means that fact-checkers, because otherwise they don't have funds to do their work, so it's a bit of a bargain with the devil, I guess. But there's a pushback, in other words, against fact-checkers saying, well, you're doing the work of the platforms, or you're doing the work of the West and these big tech. So I think that is a real problem, that fact-checking itself is becoming problematic for various reasons. Clovis, your point about Putin and Xi, absolutely. I think that is also often a case where people seek to find disinformation to fit into that existing worldview, right? The existing idea, and also maybe the existing idea, or the idea that, for instance, Africa are these African audiences are passive, and they are stupid, or they are willing to be, you know, exploited or duped, and you know, that Western governments, especially, or Western organizations, maybe try and find disinformation, Russian disinformation, for instance, to confirm that. Whereas, as I've quickly alluded to, some of our research shows clearly that there's a rising anti-Western attitudes, also anti-democratic attitudes, and there's this sort of historical legacy of, for instance, Russia and China for supporting liberation movements in Africa. So the problem is not necessarily that you have to counter that disinformation with maybe other information or other Western disinformation, if you want, depending on how you're inclined. The problem is the attitude and where that attitude comes from. And where does the attitude, the anti-American attitude, comes from? American foreign policy, probably. You know. So that is a much longer legacy to undo than just to counter it by providing more, to debunk it. And as you say, you know, there are all these examples of that disinformation is and in the Global South, and the actors in the Global South, not limited to China and Russia, and this, you know, the West has been very active in that. And not only disinformation, but also influence operations in a more overt way. You can think about soft power. Yes, China has recently embarked on soft power, which is becoming a bit more hard-edged in recent years in Africa, but the West has been involved in soft power actions for many years in Africa. So again, we should guard against, I think, against that sort of amnesia, or guard against the notion that disinformation is something that is only happening within this contemporary geopolitical framework. About data manipulated and how do we get access to good data, I think that is why primary research is so important, and that why it is important to for us as researchers to do primary field work and not only rely on data that we get from these big sort of data sets, but also, and here I think I would maybe argue also for a more qualitative approach, that ethnographic, there's very little ethnographic research, comparatively speaking, compared to quantitative research in the area of disinformation. And in that article by Suhana Udupa that I mentioned in India, where she talks about shadow politics, she actually shows how the notion of data is becoming a sort of political rhetorical tool, and what counts as data is you know, often, you know, very wide, and includes disinformation data that's produced, or includes disinformation produced online through Cambridge Analytica and these sort of organizations. So again, I think I would argue that as cultural and social and historical factors are so important in the Global South, we need more qualitative, more slower, more immersed, and more ethnographic research. Of course, that is really difficult to do in terms of access. It's difficult and costly. We don't always have the resources to do do that. And I think it's also important that we go beyond just the online space, that we really spend time in offline spaces. So some colleagues in South Africa, and for instance, the University of Johannesburg, have done this during the COVID period, where a lot of research was based on online, what are the sort of disinformation circulating on Twitter and social media. But they have actually spent time in the lines, the queues, where people stand and get government grants and speak to people and just say, you know, because these are often the people that aren't active online, but they, you know, they're often representative of the poor majority in the country, and speak to them face to face, spend time with them, do that ethnographic research. It's slow, it's costly, it's time consuming. But I think given the problems that you point out in terms of data, that's also really important. Okay, so take some more questions. Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. It's a wonderful presentation and discussion. I've been reading a lot and hearing a lot of well-educated scholars and researchers speaking about journalism as being Western-centric, as having biases from the global north and rooted in liberal democracies that and usually with a criticism they don't apply in other contexts. And I'm just wondering what you think about that line of thought, and would just add that in some of what I read in here, it's almost as if any form of what's called journalism is okay, and that if you think of how it's practiced in one particular context, that's almost like sacrosanct to that context, and it's equally legitimate and valid as other forms or approaches to journalism that may be rooted in the more traditional principles and practices. So I don't know, but I'd like to, I mean, I don't know what I think altogether of all these things, but I'd like to hear what you think about that, and where do you see a legitimate need for some really critical rethinking about what we're trying to achieve and what we're trying to teach and do in journalism in countries in the Global South, and where you think those more traditional aspects that are associated with or labeled as Western might actually be more than that.
Hi, my name is Harshaman Mahajan. I'm a postdoctoral scholar at the Institute. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation. I agree that this information is very important. The thing I want to draw your attention is your chapter in the book where you have reviewed different studies on disinformation. In this chapter, you have mentioned that there were studies about deception, rumor, propaganda, falsehood for a long time, and it stopped after Cold War. And it get boom in a way after 2016 with the rise of populism and everything. So I was thinking, wasn't there any issues about propaganda before 2016? So what we can know about this politics of, or political ignorance of research through this phenomena. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Yeah. My name is Deepak. I specialize in international relations. I am from India. So today there was a report from the World Economic Forum which put India as the ranking in the number one as the countries at the risk of, highest at the risk of false information or misinformation. You mentioned that today this is a year of elections. Now India is going to have election, and Indian election, it's like, it's going to be a super election because it's like humanity's largest election. Now the fact is, one of the key reasons why the Nationalist Party has dominated the Indian political landscape has been how successfully they have used, leveraged, manipulated the digital media. And there are quite a lot of reasons in this because, as you mentioned, the IT cells. Now, literally, there are millions of IT cells working for these parties. And the propaganda is so structured, it is done so systematically that one wonders how actually can you combat it. Because even now in India, there are significant number of fact-checking institutions, independent journalists, everything. But when you see the scale, it kind of feels that the only solution would be counter propaganda of another scale to tell the other side. And adding to the fact is that WhatsApp is the biggest medium in India, if you talk in social media. And data is super cheap in India. It's good. Connectivity is hugely improving now. You know, you buy a packet of chips for 20 rupees, that's less than one real. They give you 2 GB data free. It's that easy to get data. So how do you combat things of this scale? Because in India, the numbers are always huge, and the scale is mind-blowing. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Maria. I'm an undergraduate fellow here. You spoke a little bit about the mediums through which this information is spread, and you talked about, you know, digital, but also hard news. And my question is, you know, we often talk about how information is spread differently in different countries, and specifically focusing in the global south that has its particularities. But when we talk about the mediums through which the information is spread, they're still often imported, even if they're used within the particularities of each country. So I guess I'm just asking, what do you think is the path to both understanding academically, you know, the intersection between these mediums, you know, platforms or, you know, journalistic formats like news shows, for example, which are, you know, produced very similarly in different countries. How do you see us understanding the intersection between those mediums and the particularities in each country? And what would be a framework for understanding those and tackling this information in this context of, you know, merging global north formats with global south particularities?
Thanks. I think, was there one more question over here? I think it was two. Okay.
Hello. Hello. My question was quite practical in the sense that you had discussed the idea of the importance of media literacy. And I wondered whether you had any great examples of media literacy programs that were running anywhere in the world that would be good as a sort of a benchmark, particularly within youth environments and student settings. Thanks.
I'd also like to extend on the same question in a sense that, like, you talked about how in an offense pair, there's also this huge trend of misinformation that goes through more traditional means like TV or like even in places where there is very limited access to networks or internet or electricity in that particular case, right? So we're talking about very limited communities. Like, what's more realistic examples or actors through which we understand misinformation in this particular context when it comes to like offline mediums?
Okay, thank you. Shall I maybe try and attempt some of these responses? I mean, and not that I necessarily have the answers, but I think these are really important questions to keep thinking about. Maybe the first question around journalism, Western-centric, whether it's rooted in liberal democratic frameworks and so on. I think a lot of that criticism is valid to start with. I think the criticism also that journalism training and education, for instance, in Africa, has often been sponsored and supported by Western philanthropy or educational institutions and so on. That, I think, is a fact. It's a historical fact. The problem, the question is, what do you do with it? I think journalism and the values, and I've actually done quite a bit of research quite a bit of time ago around media ethics, for instance. And when we talk about media ethics and normative frameworks, is it possible to think about a global media ethics, for instance, given that media is globalized? Is it possible to arrive at some sort of framework? I think the problem that one bumps into there is the question of relativism, that you can, that while it is important to, and this is Cliff Christians, actually a media ethicist who's made this distinction between, and I'm not doing necessarily his argument justice, but the value relativism versus a sort of cultural and conceptual relativism,
where there are, and again, his notion of sort of proto-norms, that certain things that we can agree on, should agree on, and that globally, and that also if you look empirically at how people have operationalized them, things like the sacredness of life, truth-telling, human dignity, non-malfeasance, not harming people. These are principles that people around the world tend to agree with. The question is how they are operationalized within specific cultural and social and historical conditions. I think there is a real need for us to keep criticizing, keep critiquing the colonial heritage of journalism and media, the notion of decoloniality, decolonizing is high on the agenda of scholarship at the moment. And again, I think rightly so. The field has historically been dominated by perspectives, values, etc., from the West. At the same time, I think there is also a danger that it can become a sort of knee-jerk rejection of anything and everything that comes from the North and can become very crude. And sometimes also, I think some of this decolonial scholarship tends to neglect or tends to be ignorant of a longer history of post-colonial critique, for instance, that shows notions of hybridity. And there, Dean Crady is the expert, but I mean, if you think about hybridity, the impossibility of disentangling necessarily these, you know, global South and North, and that they are entwined in complex ways. And so that I think the sort of crude arguments often for rejecting whatever comes from the global North is not helpful. But at the same time, I think that critique is important for us to keep talking about. The question, I think, around the disinformation that studies that peaked in 2016, if I understand correctly, and what about studies about propaganda prior to that? I think that is exactly, one could maybe, you know, the research that we did over those two decades, we used specific keywords that are now current, things like disinformation, misinformation, false information. But that is, I think, exactly the critique against the field that scholars say that there has been or had been a long-standing scholarship around propaganda, for instance, that goes back all the way, you know, to World War. And I think that is exactly the point that I think now we have reached this such explosion of disinformation scholarship since 2016, driven by all these factors that I've mentioned. But that there was this rush, I think, maybe just to sort of to do work in this area. And I think it's now time for us to slow down maybe and look back and say, go back to these historical studies of propaganda and look at how we can use the insights from that historical research. So not only in terms of that 2016 marked this sort of explosion of disinformation studies because of a particular perspective from the global North, but also that it tend to conceptualize this information in certain ways that tend to neglect and ignore older scholarship, longer standing traditions of propaganda studies and soft power and so on. But I hope that answers the question, or at least goes some way to do that. The question around India, absolutely. This is the scale, you know, it, as you say, it is mind-boggling, it is big. I'm not an expert on India. I can only, you know, reference to the work that you know I've read from, for instance, Udupa and others. I don't know what the answer is in terms of how to counter it. Safe to say that I think what it shows is that this has become an intrinsic feature of politics and democratic politics around the world, and that in these examples of India, it can show exactly how mind-boggling the extent of that is. So Udupa's suggestion in that article, the idea of the shadow that has always been not talked about, the shadow politics, it is still frowned upon, the sort of paid for this disinformation for hire, but it is now completely enmeshed, linked to mainstream. So the shadow and what happens above the platform you cannot separate them anymore. And so that is increasingly going to become a feature of electoral politics around the world. And I think that is why it's so important for us to this year to pay attention to that. But I don't really have an answer in terms of how one should counter that. But trying to understand the context and trying to understand what drives it, I think, is probably a good start. Then there was the question around how mediums that are important from the West, if I understand you correctly, how they are used in other contexts. I think here, again, it is useful to go back further even than social media and look at, for instance, the introduction of mobile phones. Even back to SMS technology, there have been interesting studies around that that are already, you know, maybe 2 decades old or so, that shows how these platforms that are introduced, that come from the West and developed somewhere else, that are introduced in the South, are adopted and adapted and appropriated in creative and interesting and often unpredictable ways. The very notion of texting instead of voice calling comes from a sort of low data environment, for instance. And so it is, again, important not to fall into the trap of technological determinism. And again, the notion of technological determinism is something that predates social media and disinformation studies, but the assumption that technologies will have the same, that influence and impact everywhere, regardless of where they are introduced. So it's important, again, to think about and to pay attention to how people use them and adopt them and adapt them within these other non-Northern contexts. There were two other questions. I think the one was, on how do we study actors and disinformation actors offline that are not online necessarily. I'm not sure if I understood that question correctly. I think it is important for us, just to reiterate, I think it is important for us to understand how the offline and the online world are connected, and it's not to say that disinformation offline circulates completely separate from online environments, but I think the question was, who are the actors there, right? And so I think, again, if we look at the Global South and certainly in the African context, things, influences like religious leaders, for instance, family leaders, the family, very important. Also in terms of how people correct or don't correct disinformation in the African context, you do not necessarily want to be correcting your elders. It's seen as a form of disrespect. And so in some of the focus group research that we've done among young people, media literacy work, let's say something about that now, but it has shown that people say, well, I received this information from my mother or my grandmother. I know it's not right, but I'm not going to correct her. It's not right. It's not respectful. So that is then allowed to pass through. So I think it is important to look at the influence of the family, influence of religious leaders, influence of older, senior people in these environments that play an important role. And lastly, I think in terms of media literacy, I must admit that's not my area of expertise, although that didn't prevent me from doing a little bit of work on it. But we have done, for instance, media literacy work with Africa Check, the fact-checking organization, where we have, they have developed a curriculum for young people, for schools, and we tested that in focus groups among young people. There's important work done by the organization called Learn Asia. They're one of the teams in that multi-country project that I'm running, that they do really good work in Asia. They're based in Sri Lanka, but they do media literacy work in the region. I would say that what is interesting in our findings from our media literacy, a little bit of media literacy research in the South African context, was that young people are overwhelmed, and they are overwhelmed with this confusing world out there in a way. And what they report often is that they are so familiar with the dangers. They are constantly, from school level, through these media literacy campaigns, constantly made aware of be safe online, don't trust everything, don't believe what you read, that in effect the media literacy campaigns have had the effect not of making them more critical, but making them cynical in this, to the extent that they don't believe anything anymore. In other words, they just believe what they want. And I think that is that's a question for media literacy research that we need to maybe start exploring a bit more. To what extent media literacy campaigns of young people can also make them feel disempowered and feel overwhelmed. And that's at least one of the small findings that we've done in our research in South African young people, among young people in South Africa. I don't know how we are doing for time. Are we out of time? Okay, thanks. Okay, great, thank you. Thanks very much, everyone. Thank you.